I was supposed to be here early. They gave me another assignment. They didn't pick me up to go to the assignment. I followed their instructions and waited at the hotel. I would love to be here when I can be more fully in depth on this subject, because there's a whole lot of illusions about Africa's relationship with other people in the world. There's a whole lot of illusion about our relationship to the religions in the world. And these belief systems that had its origin in Africa, all of them, and there is no exception, turned on African people. I said there is no exception. And there's one thing you have to get through your mind and keep it. Nothing that ever came from the European mind was meant to do anything but facilitate European domination of the world. And I said, there's no exception. Everything that was brought into this continent, everything, every idea, every so-called religion, was meant to dominate and to control. The Arabs had no illusions about it. The Europeans had no illusions about it. You were the ones with the illusions. And yet every element that went into the making of every major religion in the world started in Africa. Why is it that you are so naive? You let people redress something that you invented, sell it back to you, and enslave you through it. I'm saying that all organized present religions are male chauvinist murder cults. And I say there is no exception. Why I wanted to be here earlier, I wanted to deal with our relationship with the people of the world and the fact that we created peaceful nations that had no word for jail because no one had ever gone to one. No word for old people's home because no one ever threw away grandma and grandpa. No word for orphanages. We did all of this, and over half of human civilization was over before we knew that a European was in the world. Before he wore a shoe or lived in a house that had a window. Now, Africa has always and still is the prize for the whole world. We as a people have always been the world's richest people, culturally rich, mineral rich. We have always been the prize because we have always had and still have something that other people won't, think they can't do without, and don't care to pay for. Because we have always been the prize, we have been under siege for over 3,000 years. Nothing that ever brought into Africa from the outside was meant to do the Africans any good. That means all other religions. Islam was the handmaiden of Arab imperialism. Christianity was the handmaiden of European imperialism. The Hebrew faith was the handmaiden of a concept called the chosen people. Now, if God is kind and God is merciful and God has no stepchildren, he won't choose one over the other. And to say he chose some people, you're making him a bigot. And to say that he endorsed enslavement of one people over the other, you're making him an accessory to murder. The Arabs used Islam to rationalize their slavery and their imperialism. The Europeans use Christianity to rationalize their slavery and imperialism. Who are you kidding about friends in the world? Damn it, if you want a friend, look in the mirror. There's a billion African people on the face of this earth. Why are you buying third-rate junk from third-rate people thinking you can't make it? Why don't you at least make a safety pin to hold your child's diaper together? Teach. Who has programmed your mind at thinking you can't make a car? The first man that made a car that had never seen one previously. The Japanese bought cars, bought locomotives, broke them down and studied them, and had a Japanese technician produce each piece, put it together, and had a much better train than the one they copied from. All knowledge in the world belongs to everybody in the world.
Yes.
Who has programmed our mind in assuming that we cannot run a nation and run it well? The main thing imperialism did, slavery and imperialism, that they removed African people from the respectful commentary of history. And they tell them something they are still telling them, and all of the organized religions are guilty of this. I favor none of it because Africa didn't need any of it. I'm saying that African belief systems, properly understood, is 10 times better than Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. And better for the Africans. Now you might have some romance with one of these religions. I have no romance with any of them. I have a romance with reality and truth. And the chips can fall where they may after I tell it. As for friends, you have had no friends. When they discovered you, they began to prey on you. Now let's look at our relationship with Western Asia, mistakenly called the Middle East. For 3,000 years, our greatest enemies came from Western Asia. They were trying to avenge the fact that they were once African colonies. You read a book called When Egypt Ruled the East, and you get some of the basic information on this. Now, the first visitors to Africa came in the 1700s BC. These were the people who would later be called Hebrews. Now, black people are ticklish on this because black people think that everything in the Bible is true. I question the intelligence of anyone who thinks everything in the Bible is true or supposed to be true. It's allegory, stories told to illustrate a point at a time when there were very few people reading books. And most of what went into the making of the Bible was copied from Egyptian texts. Now, if you want to get so dewy-eyed over the Bible, which is a carbon copy of a carbon copy, why don't you go back and read the original Egyptian text? Then you see where all these stories started from. You see where the story of the Exodus started from. Now, you get so dewy-eyed, you actually think there was an Exodus. These people walked into Africa. Why couldn't they walk out? Why did they have to go by sea? Why did she have to park? If you read Egyptian literature, you will discover that the whole story of somebody parting the sea started with about 3,000 years before the Hebrew entrance. I should not use the word Hebrew entrance, but the entrance from Western Asia. Now let's get one thing straight, because black people are confused about all religions. Now I'm not against any religion. I'm a very spiritual human being. I just don't need a preacher to preach no Ten Commandments to me when he's a backslider going with some sister, some other man's wife. I'm intelligent enough to pick from the Tenth Commandment, not commandments anyway, but they were omissions of purity at the great school at Luxor, the great African training school. All right, now, let's get into this Western Asia. I'm saying that the people who came from Western Asia escaping famine did not have any Hebrew faith when they came into Africa. And there's no record of a Hebrew faith before this. Why is it that when they left Africa in the so-called Exodus, they had all three? African culture, an African religion, and an African language. Now look at the origin of the so-called people you now refer to as Jews. You're mistaken using that reference because the word Jew is of European origin. And the people in Europe who call themselves by their name have no relationship to the biblical people of the Hebrew faith. And I'm saying that the people we now call Jews entered world history with their visit to Africa. And when Africa was invaded, 1675 BC, instead of joining the Africans who had been their beneficiary and saved them from starvation, they joined the enemies of Africa. No one has ever returned any favors to us. As a people, we have always been hospitable to strangers, mostly the wrong strangers. And what we have to understand now, in the period of superior brainwashing, is there is no European answer for African problems. Either Africans find a solution to African problems, or there is no solution. And if you don't find a solution soon, you go back into slavery. We have to stop all of this nonsense about who belongs to what religion when all of them were imposed on us in the first place. We stop all this fight between Muslims and Christians when neither one of the religions are doing them any good or moving them toward independence. All of them are handmaidens of conquerors. All of them are religions of conquerors. We were naive when we accepted their interpretation of something that we had all along. I'm saying we need to take a good look at ourselves. I'm not talking about burning churches. I'm not talking about getting rid of religions. Understand me well. I am saying that every single thing that touches your life, religious, socially, and politically, must be an instrument of your liberation, or you must throw it into the ash can of history. Develop a liberation Islam.
Yes.
And if you develop a liberation Islam, you'd have to turn on the supreme slave traders who were in the slave trade 1,000 years before the Europeans, the Arabs.
Yes.
And most brothers who think they're Muslims are merely Arabists. Forerunners, vanguards of Arab propaganda. The Arabs are not above joining the Jews against black people. In America, they're already doing it in Detroit. In America, they're already doing it in real estate. You got some dewy-eyed thing that you got a friend. I still ask you to look at that mirror. And if nothing's staring back at you is friendly, then you've got no friend. But this is where you start, friend. All right. I'm saying something which you need to reconsider. I'm saying that everything that came into Africa, every people that came into Africa, did not come to do Africa any good. Everyone and every religion and every people who came into Africa declared war on African cultures. They began the bastardization of African people, created a confused mulatto who didn't know whether he's to be loyal to his mother's people or his father's people. That confusion is still here. The fascination for the color of the conqueror and the fascination to go to bed with the conqueror. Now that's raw and mean, but it's true. Now, sometime ago, a North African leader, Gaddafi, was sending some Libyans to study in Europe. And he told them what any good nationalist would tell students going to study. I'm not sending you to Europe to find a wife. I'm sending you to Europe to gain the technology to come back and make Libya a strong nation, a strong Islamic nation, and a strong Arab nation. And you cannot achieve any of this between the legs of a European woman. When is somebody going to get strong enough to tell Africans going to school, you're going to come back home and pair up with a sister. But if you want to pair up over there, stay over there. Now, the one thing we have to look at, and I'm sorry, I'm going to have to conclude on this because I've left out a body of information. At the university, I teach an entire course, semester course, on Africa's relationship to other people. And I devote several semesters to Africa before Europe, the consequences of the coming of the Greeks, who stole a lot that they think is their culture, stole a lot that you think is Greek philosophy. We've been the victims of propaganda. And yet, if you read the Journal of African Civilization, other works, we have lived in Europe, we've lived in Asia, we've lived in the Americas. The African people have already proved that they can get along with different people, amalgamate their culture with different people without one hint of a war between us. People who come into Africa immediately declare war on African culture, standards of beauty, standards of conduct, and change the African concept of theirs so they can rule through him. This was true of the Greeks, who began the bastardization, again, the European bastardization of Africa. The Western Asians had begun it 3,000 years before that. The Romans, a bunch of well-dressed thugs who could write well but couldn't think, who borrowed practically everything. They laughed at the Africans' concept of Christianity. The African was practicing and not giving it a name. This is why you don't know nothing about the African origins of Christianity. This is why a whole lot of people will not read Ben Yorkinen's The African Origins of the Major Western Religions, Africa, Mother of Western Civilization, a Black Man of the Nile. Because he's telling it like it is, but you also will not read white radicals who identified Africa as the origin of the great religions of the world, especially Alvin Boyd Kuhn in his work, Who is This King of Glory? In Shadow of the Third Century. We have dealt with John Jackson, another radical Black historian, with man, God, and civilization. We let some of our great scholars die in hunger, die wanting for friendship. Now, having devoted my greater portion of my life to scholarship and teaching and digging up information on African people and trying to make African people face reality, I have often said, a point that I wish you to consider, I didn't have to do it. I chose to do it, and if I had to do it over again, I would do it better. I have a lot of talent other than the talent to teach and to research. I've never met a rich man who had a better mind than me. So if I wanted to succeed as a rich man, I could have done that. I never met a crook who wasn't a fool. I could have been a good crook if I chose to be a crook. I chose to be a teacher of African history. I chose to look in the Bible where I couldn't find my people. I started looking for them in the world, and I didn't stop until I found them. And I know why they are left out of the Bible. I know why all the angels are white. You mean to tell me God is merciful, God is kind, and not one little brown or black angel sneaked into heaven? I ain't buying that. Now, the Bible that you get so dewy-eyed over is one of the greatest pieces of propaganda ever written. If you want to read the Bible, why don't you read the Bible one day and read Mein Kampf the next day and see the comparison? That's hard on your mind. Because you think if you don't have Christianity, Islam, or Judaism, you don't have to have spirituality. I've got more spirituality after I put all of them down. And I've got more religion after I put all of them down. All right, now let me conclude something that has no conclusion. We have to look at the impact of Europeans on Africa. All impacts have been negative. The Romans laughed at the early African Christians. Finally, for political reasons, they stopped killing Christians and became Christians. I'm saying the European became Christian for political reasons, as the Arabs became Muslim for political reasons, and as the so-called Jews became Hebrews for political reasons. People use organizations for political reasons, and what we get so dewy-eyed and think we're dealing with the truth. If you look at indigenous African religious belief systems, if you look at the idea when Africans had no churches of any consequence, because these fools came here and said, this is the house of God, and the African looked at that church and said, if God who made the wind, the spring, made the ocean roar, and you gonna tell me he can fit into a little thing you call a church? That is no house of God. So some of them had the common sense enough to move away from it, and some had the common sense to burn it down. I'm saying that you're closer to God when the further way you get away from organized religions that are all handmaidens of conquest. The Roman Empire developed during the early period of Christianity. Remember, the Roman Empire started in Africa. It rose in Africa, it fell in Africa. A lot of people need to stop reading some religious books and read some straight history without fable, without supposition, without myth. Read straight history. Read the Mediterranean world in ancient times. She's a racist bigot, but her chronology is good. And there's a good history of the European trying to move out of Europe into the Mediterranean to find something to eat to put on that gosh darn awful European food. He has solved his problem at the expense of other people. The slave trade liberated Europe from the depressed economy they had created with the so-called crusades and through the famines and the plagues. Europe always solves its problems by preying on people outside of Europe. They are in a position right now that they have betrayed true socialism, which was not of European origin in the first place. And some people are confused between Karl Marx and Groucho Marx. I think a lot of people are Groucho Marxism instead of Karl Marxism. They're funny people. And if you think that that system started in Europe, no system as humane as socialism could have started among a bunch of icebox people who prey on their brothers for their breakfast. Read Palmer Colson's work, The History of the Modern World, especially the early chapters. Now, the evidence of Africans in the New World, the evidence of 1,000 years of civilization before slavery, all of this I'm not discussing because there is no time. But when the Romans disgraced themselves in the mismanagement of Christianity, they created a vacuum. Islam moved into that vacuum. The Africans thought that Islam would get the Romans off of their back. They were right. Islam got the Romans off of their back, and the Arabs jumped on their back, and they're still there, using Islam to justify it. Now, the African military man, because we are the greatest fighting machine in the face of the earth, if we ever discovered this, people gonna start running. Under proper leadership, proper inspiration, properly equipped, the black man is the greatest human fighting machine God ever created, if indeed God created it. I think the gods of Africa created it. Once you lose track of your heritage, you lose track of your liberty in this world. The Europeans doing the slave trade not only read the African out of history, they colonized history, they colonized information about history. They colonized image. They colonized the image of God. Who told you Christ was white? He was born in that part of the world predominantly occupied by non-European people. So you should not get into the argument about whether he's white. All you have to say, was he a Greek? No. Was he a Roman? No. But these were the only people partially white in the area at the time. If he wasn't a Greek, he wasn't a Roman, he was one of those other people. You don't have to argue about the shades of color. So far as you're concerned, once you establish he was not a Roman, he was not a Greek, your conversation is over. Now, if somebody else want to argue about his shade, well, that's their problem. And if you got a problem with color, then you got a problem with your mother and your father. You have insulted your mother and your father if you don't like what they gave you. I wear mine like a badge of honor. I dig it. I wear it well.
All right. Love it.
I'm saying, in closing, and I am closing, that what you have to do is take a holistic look. Now that, not only at your position in the world, but your potential in the world. You have to learn how to convert everything into an instrument of liberation or leave it alone. You have to realize there were no Greek fraternities and sororities until they were introduced to secret African societies. People get all dewy-eyed over something that was imposed on them in order to control them without understanding that. That's another imperial effort. So it bothers me, and although I have good personal friends who are Muslim, that not a single Muslim scholar have dealt with that 1,000 years of African independence before slavery and how the Arabs from the north systematically destroyed these nations. They actually, it did not occur. 1591, from Morocco, an army was launched against these great independent nations in inner West Africa. These were great states, and because of poor communication between African and African, there was enough armies in these states to march down to the coast and to drive every slave trader into the sea. But the communication between African and Africa was so poor. Even today, the East Africa is not too clear about what's happening in West Africa. And nobody knows what's happening in North Africa because the conspiracy to hold on to Africa is happening in South Africa and in North Africa. So the whites in North and South Africa willing to play a part, and the pseudo-whites in North Africa willing to play a part. In all this world, you have no friends. But if there are a billion of you on the face of this earth scattered all over the world, what do you need with a friend other than yourself? Why can't you turn inward on yourself and say, I will wear no clothes I don't produce. Start with your underwear. I wear no shoes that's not made by a brother. You're creating a shoe factory, employment at once. Start buying aeroplanes, break them down and study them, later on make aeroplanes. What this whole thing is about is the restoration of confidence. It has been the role of these handmaidens of colonialism to destroy your confidence in yourself. You don't believe that you can look like a god. You don't believe a black father in your home is to some extent a god. That won't make the black woman less than a goddess. Because we produced the first human societies that recognized and respected the female god. We produced the first human societies that you can't be a king unless you got a queen. You can't be a god unless you got a goddess. So you can see all of these social ills that people are defending now, none of it started in our countries. I defy anyone alive, and those who want to come alive, come back and prove me, I invite them too, to show me one single case of sexual deviance or maladjustment any place on the African continent for the coming of foreigners. I defy you to show me one case of teenage pregnancy, one case of ill treatment of women. We got confused with someone else's ideas, someone else's concept and definition of us. What we have to understand is that faith has not spared us for an idle reason. A whole lot of people who've been hit less than us are extinct. What is there in us that made us strong enough to take this heavy blow? 500 years of slavery, one way or the other, slavery, neo-colonialism. What made us strong enough to survive? What has faith saved us to do? And inasmuch as we gave the world its first humanity, faith has saved us to give the world its last humanity. What we have to do is to believe it, to believe that we are worthy of it, and to believe that we are capable of it. What black studies should be about, what black religion should be about, is the restoration of the confidence. And the restoration of the confidence is we must rule the state again. There is not an imitation nation that not an independent nation in Africa or the Caribbean Islands. They're all imitation European states. And what we have to understand is that the nation state is stagnant. The African did not live in a nation state, he lived in a territorial state. The African learned something very basic. Cultures have to be fertilized by cultures. People have to be fertilized by the interaction between cultures and cultures. This insecure European tightened his borders. You know, you got a passport to come here? The word passport is not in any African language. The things he invented to restrict himself, he imposed on other people. Once we gain confidence in ourselves, and once we look at that person staring back at us from that mirror and like what we see, and don't move from that mirror until you like what you see. Then, in coordination with other African people throughout the world, we will give the world a new lease on life. We will turn to all of our people and not one part of them. Because we came from a matrilineal society that respected women to the point the lineage came down to the female side. We must answer the call of the great African-American poet, Margaret Walker, who said, let the dirges end, let a new peace begin. Let us write a new covenant for the freedom of ourselves in the world. African men throughout the world need to step forward and answer Sister Margaret and say, Sister Margaret, we have heard your call. And because we have never been a society that excluded women, with our women at our side, we are ready to pick up the challenge. We are ready to start a revolution that will change the world. We won't get ready tomorrow because tomorrow's things are left to tomorrow. We will start our revolution right now, and we will start it with ourselves. Thank you.
since we have run over our time, I'm not quite sure what I should do since we have run over our time, but I know that there are some people who think, and we will try to have maybe just two or three questions. I see a hand. You'll have to speak very loudly.
Syria is safe. We really have problems with the World Bank. And when we are in trouble, we are told in this country where our growth rate is 5%.